bankers who brought the global economy to the brink of ruin, their social margin contribution was unambiguously very, very negative. Their contribution to their own firm was very negative. They brought their enterprises to the brink of ruin. And yet they walked off with bonuses in the millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions of dollars. It was very clear that there was no connection between their compensation and social contribution. Well, the other justification of all this was an idea called trickle-down economics. Don't worry about what is going to the top. That's what one of our presidential candidates, Mitt Romney, once called the politics of envy. What you want to know is what's happening to all of society. They put forward an idea called trickle-down economics, that the benefit money to the top benefits everybody in society. So what I say is, you know, I wish trickle-down economics were true, because if it were true, the average in the United States would be doing very well. But you saw those numbers I gave you before, and they showed the basically the average income at the bottom 9% has not changed. And trickle-down economics has not been working. And another way of looking at it is looking at median income, which today is lower than it was 17 years ago. Median income looks at obviously an average over all households. More telling is looking at particular demographic groups. And if you looked at the election this year, some of you may have seen some of the primary debates, and in the primary debates you saw a lot of angry white males, middle-aged males, and questioning, you know, what was going on? Well, this graph shows you why there was such anger. The median income of a full-time male worker, and remember, many of these were getting a full-time job is really hard for people in their 40s and 50s. So this exaggerates how well they're doing. Those who have a full-time job, their median income is lower than it was 40 years ago. So when you've been told every generation is going to do better than the last, and for two generations now, it's been going down, there is a real sense of frustration, a sense that the system is rigged, the system is unfair, something is wrong. They've been working hard, at least they believe they've been working hard, they played by the rules, so, you know, but the system has not been delivering for them. The pictures in Europe are a little better, but not much better. Median household income in Italy has been going down. These are all adjusted for inflation. At the bottom, though, as I said, things are much worse. At the bottom in the United States, real wage and hourly compensation, real wage at the bottom, are at the same level that they were 60 years ago. Right? Give this kind of talk in China, they can't believe it. You know, 60 years ago, their per capita income, 40 years ago, their per capita income was $150. You know, their world has changed in 40 years. It's a different world. And for, you know, when I say, you know, American at the bottom, their income, you know, is lower than the same level of 60 years ago, in a period that they moved 800 million people out of poverty, they say, what's wrong with your economic system? And the fact is, increasingly, that Americans are coming to the view that an economic system that doesn't deliver for a very large fraction of the population is obviously an economic system that is not working. Trying to understand why it's not working is really the core of the issue, these data should make you convinced that it's not working. Well, there are multiple aspects of this inequality. when I was chief economist of the World Bank, we did a survey of 10,000 people who were in poverty, and we wanted to know what were the aspects of poverty that were most eviscerating, most harmful to them. Obviously, lack of income was one of them. But two other things that they talked a lot about, everybody talked about, was insecurity. They were based on kind of vulnerability to carelessness. But the other thing was lack of voice. The fact is that they didn't have any say of the things that were affecting them. And that really, really was a concern. And that is really a problem in the United States today and in many other advanced countries, which is why the voter turnout is so low. And the last election illustrates that. Trump got fewer votes than Romney, who lost in the previous election. In some of our congressional elections, we have a voter turnout. The youth voter turnout in some of our elections is comparable to our youth unemployment rate. When it was at the peak, 20% was the voter turnout of young people. And obviously, why is that? These are people who you would have thought had the most at risk of making sure the system was working for them. But they become convinced that our democracy doesn't work. Access to justice is another important aspect. The United States has 5% of the world's population, 25% of the world's prison population. One out of four of people in prison are in the United States. And it's overwhelmingly African American, a real example of lack of access to justice. And mass evictions in the last crisis where we threw out people who didn't even owe money. The banks would sign a statement, or more accurately, we have local signers who are signing statements saying that the banks, that these individuals owe money when they didn't, and they would be thrown out of their homes and without really any recourse. Wealth inequality is greater than income inequality. I tell my students there is one really important decision that you can make in your life, and if you make that decision wrong, things are over. And that decision is choosing the right parents. And I'm going to describe eight Americans who made the right decision. From two families, and so they worked hard to choose wealthy parents and inherit their money, so they didn't actually do anything. And those are two from the Walton family, the Walmart, famous for their gender discrimination, bad labor relations, and in the case of Mexico, a massive corruption. And the Koch brothers, who were famous for intervening, trying to make sure that the United States exceeds China in air pollution. So far, you know, we slipped into second. We are number one in carbon dioxide per capita, but China has more capita outweighs the United States. But Koch brothers are working very hard to make sure that we reassert our number one position. Well, these eight people have as much wealth as the bottom 44% of America. For 150 million Americans, which is in part testimony to how much wealth there is at the top, but also how little wealth at the bottom. And I'll give it in a few minutes some numbers at the global level, which are even more devastating. Not surprisingly, when you have a society that is that divided and that is that materialistic, it's not easy to be poor, and it imposes a lot of stress, and United States is the only country, advanced country, that doesn't recognize access to health care. I should make one exception to the Troika. Also does not recognize the right of access to health care and is doing a very effective job of destroying health care systems in Spain and Greece and putting them into a developing country status. The consequence of this has been devastating in the United States. And these are some study results by Ann Case and Angus Deaton. Angus Deaton got the Nobel Prize in 2015. It's an interesting study because, for those who are graduate students, because quite often you think that you have to get a special data set, and you work very hard to get a data set. What they did is decided to look at the CDC, which is the website provided by the U.S. government, publicly available data. And they said, let's look at the data. Nobody had looked at the data before in the way they did, and the results were devastating. What the results were showing is that the mortality rate of whites in the United States were rising dramatically. Mortality rate is the probability of dying. It's the opposite of the life expectancy. So we're saying life expectancy was decreasing. So mortality rates of whites with a high school degree, only a high school degree, and that those mortality rates were actually, had risen to the point that they were actually higher than the average for African Americans, which had, again, a very stark outcome. As they looked at this kind of thing, it was getting much worse in every age cohort. The third column here shows contrast what has been happening to whites in America comparison to what's happening in every other civilized country where it's going down. And so it's really sharply in contrast. And the final section there identifies why the death rate is going up. These are deaths of despair. These are suicides, alcoholism, and drug overdose. And these are such magnitudes that are showing up. We're talking about millions of people and showing up in the macro data. So much so that by 2015, the average life expectancy in the United States went into decline. So these are dramatic. Again, when I was chief economist of the World Bank, there was one other case where we saw something like that, and that was at the moment of the dissolution of the Soviet Union. We had income data that said that incomes were going down by 25%, 30%. We were not sure about our data because it's very hard to get good income data. Demographic data is often more reliable. And when we got demographic data that said that life expectancy was going down by 2 years, particularly for males, particularly for alcoholism, we knew that society was falling apart. And this, to me, is, next to the election of Trump, the most convincing evidence that something is wrong in our society. Well, as I said, there are many other aspects of inequality, and to me the most invidious is opportunity, because Americans like to think of themselves as the American dream, land of equal opportunity, and others think of America that way. But the data is increasingly showing that that's a myth. Like you said today, is a myth. These are stories that are told, but they're told, they're not based on facts. Now, everybody knows somebody that has made it from the bottom to the top. Newspapers write about it all the time. But when you think about about it, newspapers write about things that are unusual. They don't write about dogs that bite people, but they do write about people, I mean, the people that bite dogs. That's newsworthy. And for somebody to make it from the bottom to the top is newsworthy. It happens very seldom. But as a social scientist, what do you mean by that? You mean by equality of opportunity, what you mean is, what is the probabilities? What is the mobility matrix? What are the correlations across generations? And in those terms, the life opportunities of a young American are more dependent on the income and education of his parents than in almost any other advanced country. And in a way, it's not a surprise because there is a lot of intergenerational transmission of advantage, and the rich make sure that their children do better. The rungs of the ladder in a more unequal society are further apart, and it's harder to make it up those rungs of the ladder. So this is a graph that was done by Miles Horrock, who's done some of the best work in this area. And on the horizontal axis is income inequality, measured in the usual Gini coefficient. And on the vertical axis is a measure of generational earnings elasticity, correlation between the parent and the children. And what you see there is two things. There are a group of countries that have a lot of equality, the Scandinavian countries. And those are countries with the highest equality of opportunity. At the other extreme, you have the countries with the highest levels of inequality, United Kingdom and United States, and the lowest level of equality of opportunity. And there is one other country up there in that corner, which is Italy, which some of you should try to explain. Finally, talk a little bit about global inequality. What the chart that I just showed had one important implication. There are very big differences of inequality across countries and inequality of opportunity across countries. And these countries are all the economic laws, the economic forces are very similar. They're not exactly the same, but they're very similar. What explains the differences is differences in the choices they make, the policy frameworks that they make. And that's why I've said that inequality of the richest globally is that there were no borders. And asked which groups have done well and which groups have done very poorly. And there are two groups that have done very well. One of them is the 50th percentile, 60th percentile. That's the middle class in China and India and the emerging markets. That's the newly created middle class, and they've done very well. The other group that's done very well are the global 1/10 of 1%, global billionaires. Now, for those of you who are feeling compassionate about the global billionaires, they aren't doing as well as the global middle class. Their income has only gone up 60%. You have to remember that 60% of a multi-billion-dollar income is a lot more than 120% of a $7,000 income. So that although in percentage terms, the global billionaires have not been doing as well, in absolute terms, the global billionaires are not suffering a great deal. They've actually been doing, in absolute terms, better than anybody else. Well, there are two groups that are doing very badly, those at the bottom. Those are people, farmers in Africa, India, who have been hurt by So we've really contributed to their suffering. But the other group that has been doing very badly, the worst group, is that in the 80th to 90th percentile. That's the middle class in Europe and America. So when you get a global picture, the anger that you see in this middle class, working class, depending on the language you use, the working class, these are the groups that are doing very, very badly. If you look at it in terms of wealth, you get the same picture. Every year at Davos, Oxfam comes out with a very powerful report where they describe a bus that has as much wealth as the bottom 3.5 billion people. And when they first did this study in 2014, the size of the bus was 85 people have as much wealth as the bottom 2.5 billion. About half of them were at that meeting. Countries implies that it is not a result of inexorable economic forces, but of the choices countries have made. The third, I haven't been able to show, but is was the whole point of my book called The Price of Inequality, that economies with less inequality and less inequality of opportunity perform better. And there are many reasons for this that I lay out in my book, but the point I want to make is this, you might say, is a natural position of the left wing, but I want to emphasize this is no longer viewed as a left wing position. The IMF has been doing very good empirical work in this area. They've made this conclusion that more inequality leads to poor economic performance, both in terms of growth and instability, a central part of their policy message. And for those of you who don't know, the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, is not a left-wing organization. The evidence for them was so compelling that they made this important part of their message. The final point is Kuznick's law. Kuznick's writing in this period that I described earlier in my talk, the 1950s, what I described before as the golden age of capitalism, had described how in the early stages of capitalism there's a growth of inequality, but then there's a decline. And there are good theoretical reasons for this and wealth of empirical evidence for that. But of course, he could not have anticipated in 1955 what was going to happen in 1980. And that was, instead of the decline in inequality continuing, it reversed. And the result is that there's been this enormous increase in inequality. So I say, Kuznick's law has been repealed. Laws in economics are different from laws in physics. They can be repealed more easily. Just a amusing story about, Trump doesn't believe in laws in economics either. But in that part of there are parts of the country in the United States that also have a skeptical view, like he does, of science. And one of the state's legislature decided that it was a misuse of their students' time to learn that pi was 3.1416 dot dot dot, and that it was such a complicated number that was using the brain power of their students that could be used for more useful functions. And so the state legislature passed a law that pi would only be 3.14. Of course, it didn't change the value of pi, for those of you who know how pi is formed. It didn't, but they felt better as a result. Anyway, They, let me now come to explaining the change. The key question is, why has this, what we thought of Guzman's law, that decline in equality, why has that been reversed? What's happened? And there are a couple of alternative explanations, and I'll put them in a couple of different ways. One is that the period after World War II was an unusual period. It was a period of people that fought together, a period of enormous solidarity. At that time, in the United States, when people were coming back from fighting the war, we told everybody who fought the war, and it was every male and many women, you could have as much free education at the best school that you can get into for as many years as they'll pay, as they'll accept you. So you can, if Harvard will keep you in school for 15 years, the U.S. government will pay that tuition. Today, 70 years later, America's a much richer country. But when Obama proposed that we would provide 2 years free college education in our poorest schools, our community colleges, which are the least expensive, the conclusion was we couldn't afford it. Now, obviously, we could afford it. It was a matter of choice. But in the so the view was that after the World War II, there was a sense of solidarity that this was important. So one argument is that something happened to social cohesion. The other view is, and that, and this is sort of Piketty's view, that 30 years after the war, capitalism returned to a normal state. And the normal state of capitalism is growing inequality. And that's what we are experiencing today. The other view, which is the view that I have, is that actually what happened after 1980 was not the natural workings of capitalism, but a perversion of the market economy. That what happened was that the right wing in the United States and many other countries, and the UK, and rewrote the rules of the market economy in ways that led to a more poorly performing market economy and a more unequal society. So the argument, you know, the markets don't exist in a vacuum, they have to be structured. And the way we structure them is through our legal system. And the way we restructure them led to this greater and greater inequality. So I'll try to explain, I won't be able to do it completely, why I strongly believe in the second theory. But another way of looking at this is in terms of the two standard models, one standard model, one that is basically taught, is the competitive model. Then that says that factors get paid their margin on product. Therefore, if we want to understand changes in equality, we have to understand changes in ownership of assets and changes in factor prices. And understanding these underlying driving forces leads us to an understanding of the growth of inequality. Piketty's model is an example, because he has an analysis of an increase in localization and technology that made it, would have, should have led to re-enactment of certain antitrust laws or a redesign of the antitrust laws, but instead we allowed them to get weaker, greater urbanization and globalization. And there are many examples of these rings. And the best way of understanding the data that Piketty presents, which is an increase in the wealth-income ratio, in the context of data that looks at national income account, which shows that a decline in the capital income ratio. So you have this strange, the wealth income ratio is going up for the United States and for many other countries. The wealth income ratio is going up, but the capital income ratio is going down. What's the difference? The difference is the value of land and the capitalized value of rents. And with the increased capitalized value of rents as the explanation, you have actually a diminution in the in capital labor ratios, and helping explain a weakening of wages. There's also rent seeking within corporations. I already gave an example of CEO pay. I want to bring this back to the title of my talk, Knowledge. Systems of intellectual property rights give rise to knowledge rents. IPR gives you a monopoly over the use of knowledge. Knowledge has become more important, but it's also clear, true, that there's been very big changes in the legal frameworks of intellectual property. And the consequence of those two interacting is that knowledge rents have become much more important. And knowledge rents then amplify market power. And you see that very dramatically in the case of, say, Microsoft. They had a little bit of a knowledge rent, a little bit, but they amplified that into massive market power. And they were found guilty in Asia, in the United States, and in Europe, in abuse of their market power. But that market power derived originally from was their ability to leverage market power. And they were geniuses at that. So the ability to exploit market power was an innovation, but was an innovation that led to a less efficient economy, a less productive economy, but more rents that go went to Microsoft. So that is an example of how you can wind up with more rents and a less productive economy. Let me just give one example. I know we mentioned in this quickly, but one example that I think is really important. We had a controlled experiment in a way in the United States that I was personally involved in. The question is, what can be impacted? It's not obvious. You know, this really illustrates that our legal frameworks are man-made social constructions. And what is intellectual property? What can be patented? You may have thought that you owned your own genes. But in the United States, the patent office decided, no, that was not true. And they gave a patent to a company in Utah called Myriad that there was a global effort to decode the human genome and centered in Cambridge, and it was based on target to decode the whole genome. And they realized that if they rushed, they could get a patent on some important genes, and if they could get a patent on some important genes, they could make a lot of money. And the particular genes that they got a patent on were called the BRAC genes. If a woman has these two BRAC genes, the probability of getting breast cancer is more than 70% or more. And so it's obviously important that you know that you have these genes. And they had a monopoly. They used that monopoly to say, if you want to be tested, you have to pay them several thousand dollars. The cost of the gene is a test, it's very little, but they were very profitable. What they really wanted was the data. Yale University university developed a much better test. NGOs were willing to fund that test and give it away free. In America, we don't have access to free testing. They were willing to give it away free. But Myriad said, no, we own the gene. And the result of that, of course, was with the inferior test, even people who could afford it had to take the inferior test, and some people died as a result. And of course, if you were poor, you couldn't afford the test. Anyway, so in the thousands of dollars, and many of those people died. And so with the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union, we brought a suit that went eventually to the Supreme Court. And we said, you know, there's a basic rights issue as well as an economic issue. And the Supreme Court said, you could not issue a patent on your gene. An interesting decision. But the economics, what happened after that was also interesting. Because after that, we had suddenly changed the legal framework. And what happened was prices got lower dramatically. It went down 90%. And the test got much accurate. It had stifled innovation. A great deal of harm. Well, there are multiple reasons why innovation is reduced by intellectual property rights. The importance of this can't be overemphasized because knowledge is at the core of the of our increases in standards of living and increases in life expectancy. And if we have an intellectual property regime that stifles innovation, it will obviously have large consequences. Well, let me just try to conclude. What I've tried to convey here by this one example is that, and just one example, but go through every one of the other aspects of our legal framework to show how a decision in one area creates a less productive economy and a more unequal society, a more unequal economy. And so that leads me to the most important conclusion in closed voices. These problems are deep and fundamental. Some of the alternatives have been proven their value over decades. And we should learn from these experiences to reshape our economy and reshape our globalization. If we do that, I think we can construct a world where the economy performs better for all, or at least for the vast majority of our citizens. And that brings me back again to Frank Hahn, who really did believe that economics was an important tool for reasoning about how to construct a better society. A grammar for arguing, analyzing alternatives. And I think he set an example of the kind of rigor, I apologize for some of the sloppiness of this discussion, it's not mathematical, but I thought it would be better to try to articulate the basic framework than to go into the details. I'm not sure if Frank would have approved, but I think he would approve of the bottom line of what I talked about today. Thank you.
are there any questions from the floor? You can say your name and then.
Yeah, I'm Stefano Bacci, I'm teaching in office here. Some people say that we enter the phase of low long-term growth. Do you agree with the laws of the economy or the laws of man?
Good. Yeah, that's a good question. And fundamentally, we can't answer that question because this is almost an epistemological. If we knew about the innovations that we were about to have, we would already know them. So we cannot know about what we were going to discover. So there is no way that we can really answer that. The question relates to a debate that's been going on in the economics profession between, and it goes on at two different levels. One of them is at the level of innovation, and that is Joe Volkier is on one side, Bob Gordon I'm on the other. Bob Gordon is a techno-pessimist and says that we all know that Facebook and Google think that this is an age of innovation, but in fact it doesn't show up in our productivity numbers. And Facebook says, well, maybe our measurement is wrong, and undoubtedly our measurement is wrong, but it's not that wrong. Bob Gordon says that electricity and toilets were far more important than social media. And toilets because of health and as a symbol of health standards. I think he's right on that. But that doesn't say that there won't be another big innovation going forward, and Joel Volkier is on the more optimistic side saying he thinks that there is more likely that there is more bias in the numbers and more optimistic about going forward. But on the issue of secular stagnation, which is somewhat different, and that relates to the slow growth that we've been experiencing recently. That slow growth is a result of a lack of aggregate demand. That is to say, that the economy has been operating below its potential, and if we had stronger global aggregate demand, we would be growing more rapidly. And that pushes back the question, why do we have lack of global aggregate demand? And I think there are several reasons. Growing inequality is one of them. Because people at the top consume a smaller fraction of income, and those at the bottom, when you redistribute income towards the top, it leads to lower economic growth. So that's this inequality. When I mentioned before, inequality is associated with lower growth. That's one of the reasons. So that is one of the reasons. A second reason is austerity. In many countries around the world, there is an unnecessary austerity. And Europe has bought into austerity more than any other region and suffers more than any other region. But even the United States has a mild form of austerity. And you see that in the weak economic performance. And even though we've had a officially low unemployment rate, the low labor force participation belies, it really says that we are not really operating at our full potential. So to me, it is a result of not the laws of nature, but the laws of man. And if they asked me to run our economy, I think we would have the end of this kind of secular stagnation.
Okay. public, I'm better than myself from saying, public explain the fact that in democracy, basically, there are a majority of poor people voting for rich people who are basically against redistribution and taxation.
Yeah.
Is it, this is a bit against the rationality of agencies at this point.
Well, as Ugo mentioned in his introduction, I never really believed the rationality hypothesis. And, it is always interesting that we spend so much of our time in ordinary conversation talking about how everybody that we know is acting irrationally. You know, how many conversations you probably had today talking about how somebody acting in the job or in your day-to-day life was doing something stupid, irrational. So I think irrationality is pervasive. And one of the advances in economic science over the last 35 years is the behavioral economics, which has documented the many ways in which we act irrationally. But I think it goes beyond that. In my book, The Price of Inequality, I devoted two chapters to precisely this kind of question. I don't know if I fully answered it in the United States, is the attack against the Enlightenment. You know, the set of values about how we tell the truth, how we can distinguish between what is true and what is not. The ambiguity, science has uncertainty, but we can also tell what are false statements. And the attempt by Trump to undermine those kinds of distinctions is extraordinarily dangerous for our society. Because if we can't tell what is true and what is not true, if we can't tell, we have no way of talking about systems of justice or systems of due process. It's to the point now where in effect you have to relitigate the Enlightenment every day. And I think that's enormously corrosive of our society.
What is the future of globalism with the French election on Sunday, if Lukashenko does lose? What does it say that someone like that would get as far as you get, that Trump could win, Brexit could happen? And was 2016 just a hiccup, or is globalism in trouble?
Well, globalization is in trouble. And in part, this is because globalization was oversold or missold. It goes back to the notion of trickle-down economics, the idea that globalization one of the oldest theorems in international trade is the Samuelson-Stoker theorem and the factor price equalization theorem, which said that taking down trade barriers, globalization, would lead to a decrease in wages of unskilled workers. Even taking into account that goods are more, some goods would be cheaper if you could import them. So the argument was always very clear it would have massive distribution consequences. Globalization would only be a gradual improvement if there were redistributions from the winners to the losers, and those redistributions did not occur. In fact, in this period of globalization, the tax system became less progressive in the United States. It actually became regressive with taxes that are not lower than those further down. It was argued that because of competition and globalization that brought, you had to have cutbacks in government spending. That was nonsense. That was a political agenda. But the result of that is not only did they have lower real wages, but they also faced cutbacks in public services that they received. So the way we structured globalization resulted in large fractions of our society being worse off as a result. But this is an example of what I mean by rewriting the rules of the market economy. None of this was inevitable. You could have restructured globalization. You could have structured globalization in ways that would have made everybody better off. We chose not to do that. And the point of my book, Globalization is Discontent, was to argue how you could do it. And I'm coming out with a new version called Globalization and Its Discontents Revisited, where I sort of update it in terms of focus on advanced countries and argue how we could make globalization succeed, how we could make the euro succeed. But it's not under the current rules.
A simple question, very specific. You started off speaking about inequality is the main example, which is the pay of the CEO as compared to the average worker. So I always wonder why shareholders and boards willing to pay these people so much, and I was just curious to know your view on that.
Yeah. No, that's a good question, and that is an aspect of corporate governance. Corporate governance are the rules by which corporations make decisions. And those rules basically enable the CEO to appoint the board that then approves the CEO pay. So it is a deeply corrupt system. In the United States, we had a discussion of a couple of reforms. One reform was called Say and Pay. And the idea was that the shareholders should have a direct say in the pay of the CEOs. And you would have thought, if somebody works for you, you should have some say in what they get paid. Well, the CEOs, when we proposed this idea, went crazy. They said this would destroy capitalism. It would destroy capitalism as they knew it. It's understandable why they hated this idea. But they used all their money, and they control the sea of the corporate money to lobby against it. Another example, and it just goes to something as weak as information. In Dodd-Frank, there was a provision that said that requiring corporations to disclose the ratio of the CEO pay and the top executives to the average worker. Just a disclosure. It took 5 years to get the regulations to implement that because the corporations were furious. They said, oh, we will confuse our shareholders. Someone might think what we were doing is not so good. These illustrate why it is so difficult. It's not only the level, that amount that I talked about, but the structure of the pay. Because the structure of the pay not only did not incentivize them to work hard, it actually created perverse incentives. And I described in my book, I wrote a book called The Roaring Nineties, about how these incentive compensation schemes, I have one chapter called Creative Accounting, where I showed it did not lead to more incentives on the part of CEOs except for inventing ways to increase reported profits, not real profits. And they were extraordinarily clever in doing them. Some of them were so clever that they went to prison. But, I always joke that at the business school, we try to teach them how to be clever, but not to go to prison. We don't want our students to be so clever as to go over the line. So we say, how do you maximize, but within the law?
That's a few other questions. Okay.
Hi, my name's Rory. I'm a master's student in economics here at Siena. And if you've spoken about low aggregate demand, of course, the low growth. And you've also said that one of the reasons when the government says they don't have enough money to fund free university in the United States in 2 years for students. I've just started writing my thesis about modern money theory and the potential for maybe a job guarantee or universal basic income to redress this sort of problem. And I was just curious about your thoughts on policies like that.
Universal basic, the UBI, which is a flat grant to everybody in society, is an idea that is getting increasing attention, particularly interestingly, among the very rich people of Silicon Valley. And I think the reason is they're feeling not so much guilt, but fear. In one of my books, The Great Divide, I describe a dinner party that I was at where there were many of these billionaires, and I get invited as sort of a court gesture. One of the themes that came out many times during that dinner was remember the guillotine. And it was very clear that this is very much on their minds. If we have too much inequality, we may get a social revolution or somebody like Trump. So these are the kinds of, it's clear that there's a worry. But to me, the UBI is not an adequate solution. And the reason is that even in a rich country like the United States and Switzerland, the magnitude of what one could raise for social redistribution is limited. And so if you divided that amount equally, whether they need it or not, the amount each person gets is not enough to sustain a decent standard of living for somebody who is, say, disabled. So to me, it's more important to have more targeted programs. But programs like that can be an important part of stimulating aggregate demand that would help the economy and strengthen the overall economy.
Okay, I see we have a couple of questions and then we close. This guy on the door.
About artificial inequality in the future, and also how do human challenges like climate change affect in your studies on inequality?
Okay, so let me just take artificial intelligence. There is a great deal of worry that as severe as the problems of unskilled unemployment is today and low wages of unskilled workers, they could get much worse. A few years ago at Davos, there was a lot of what I call techno-optimism. If you raise the question artificial intelligence and innovation, you say, don't worry, we've had innovation before. We had the car, and we lost jobs and buggy whips, but we got more cars and more jobs and automobile repair. So we've solved that problem before. You always create new jobs more than replace. In the last couple of years, that techno-optimism has moved to much more of a techno-pessimism. And the reason in part is that the pace of innovation has increased. Artificial intelligence, you know, these computers are not only robots are stronger than us, we know that, they've been stronger for a long while, but they can process a lot of information more rapidly. And the one example of that's been used to exemplify the challenge that we're facing is driverless cars. Driverless trucks in particular. Truck driving is, something like the largest employer of people who are not college, men who have only a high school. And it's in the several millions. And the forecast from those in the industry is that within 5 years, all trucks will be automatic, will be driverless. And that this whole occupation will disappear. Now, there's a little bit of hype because you still have to unload the trucks and load the trucks but there's no doubt that it represents a real threat to what are we going to do with the unskilled workers. The answer, we will train them and upskill them, is not a persuasive answer because not everybody can have a PhD. And even if everybody did have a PhD, what would they be doing? People are not persuaded that that is the answer. Like my answer to globalization a few minutes ago, globalization moved the utility possibility frontier out. What does that mean? So does nothing change. In other words, in principle, everybody could be better off if you had the right redistributions. And the same thing with improvements in technology. But the competitive equilibrium could result in a majority of citizens, and in particular, unskilled people with limited skills, actually being worse off. And we've had that happen in the past. For those of you who follow the literature, this is called unskilled labor-saving innovation. And there is no reason to believe that this is not going to be happening. And so unless we put in place policies that deal with this, we could have not only an anti-globalization movement, but a Luddite movement, an anti-technical change. And again, the right response is not to be anti-globalization, but to argue for the redistributions that you need to make everybody better off. And the fact that we're more productive means that we could all be made better off. The direction in which the American American society is moving is clearly very different from that. And that's why I think it is a real source of worry for the United States.
Okay, we'll let two more questions and then one and five of them.
Thank you very much. I wanted to stress that when you were presenting your presentation, you didn't give us some advantages of inequality, because inequalities might have some advantages in that in a community where there is inequality, for instance, in the company that you gave, for example, most of the CEOs we have now, what made them CEOs are their innate abilities. And our emphasis over here was more of the loss of men, but not nature. So I wanted to find out, first of all, do we have some advantages about the inequality? And then also, can't we focus more on the natural abilities so that when there is inequality in the grounds, people can build their own natural abilities better than the loss? Thank you.
Fabio, could you please give the microphone to Professor Davis?
Yes, my question is, among the reasons you indicated for the big separation between productivity growth and real wages, there was a weakening of trade unions, but they didn't say much about that. Is there some place where one can find a good description of how the legal framework was changed, which weakened trade unions and the labor movement? Thank you.
So, on the first question, advantages of globalization, advantages of inequality. Obviously, many people in the top 0.1% think it has some advantages for them. I take it the question meant, what are societal advantages? Let me make it clear that I don't think we will ever, and I'm not advocating, a regime of complete equality. You almost need some inequality to provide incentives. This is not a utopian argument that a world where everybody is just motivated by social sense of obligation. But the argument of my lecture was that we have gotten to an extreme of inequality and a source of inequality. It was not only the way it was generated, I mean, not only the magnitude, but the rent-seeking aspect of it. And the fact that the way it gets generated, that rent-seeking, the intergenerational transmission of advantages, all of that lead to a actually more poorly performing economy. So that when one says, it's not a blanket condemnation of inequality, it's sensitive to the sources of inequality and the instruments that we have to deal with that inequality. And it's interesting, I think this view that I put forward is now, as I said, becoming a mainstream view. Not only does the IMF adopted it, but The Economist magazine, which those of you know American English magazine, also is not a left-wing rag. Has also recognized that inequality in the extremes that it's become and in the manner in which it's generated is bad for the economy, for our society, for our democracy. Now, the unions represent one of the important dimensions of mechanisms, just like the way we talked before about the CEOs, that was an important mechanism. And the weakening of the unions is an important mechanism. One of the books that I did in the last couple of years was a book called Rewriting the Rules of the American Economy, an agenda. agenda for shared prosperity. And it was written basically as a platform for the Democratic Party, should they have one. And he still is. But we go through there all the major ways in which it's changed, and we talk about, for the case of the United States, the ways in which labor legislation changed in ways that weakened unions. There were also economic forces, and when you structure globalization in the way we structure globalization, that also weakened unions, because the corporation could come to the workers and say, we will take the factory away, and the union could do nothing about it. And that meant the union couldn't deliver. So the way we structured globalization undermined the ability of the unions to do what they provide, the kind of protection that unions have traditionally done. So we're doing now a book called Rewriting the Rules of the European Economy, in which one chapter will hopefully deal with the problem of how unions have been weakened. One way has been in the restructuring of the bargaining process in Europe, away from, where are the unions very strong? In Scandinavia, where they have nationwide bargaining, or sector-wide bargaining. But in many countries, they weakened those kinds of sector-wide bargaining, and with about more firm or regional-wide bargaining, and that is going to undermine the bargaining power of unions. And that then is part of a vicious circle, because when unions can't deliver as much, there's less support, and they are one of the few voices, the institutions in our society, that have been a voice for ordinary workers. And so one way of thinking about this line is these are collective action problems, that what we're talking about is how do groups in our society get together and take actions, express voice. I talk about inequality of voice. And the 1% can, you know, the Koch brothers, they don't have to get together with anybody but the Maltons or themselves. They have enough money that they can, by themselves, intervene in a significant way in the political process. A single worker can't. And so for the workers to have voice, there has to be some form of collective action. And the undermining of unions has undermined an important source of collective action, voice on the part of workers on both sides of the Atlantic.
Okay, I think we can stop there. We should thank Professor Steve.